And here's a quick tutorial on confidence intervals. In this video, I'm just going to calculate confidence intervals, actually three different confidence intervals, and then I'll answer these questions in blue where we are trying to find the proper sample size for a specified margin of error. I'll do those in a separate video just so the videos don't get too long. So we have three different confidence intervals we're trying to calculate here. They correspond with sections 9.1, 9.2, and 9.3 in our book. In 9.1, we calculate, well, let's just see what happens. So in the first problem, we're given a random sample of 100 basketball players. That's our value for n, our sample size is 100. And in this random sample of 100, the average vertical leap was 38 inches. In other words, the sample average, which we use x bar for, is equal to 38. And we somehow know that the standard deviation for all basketball players' verticals is 10 inches. Try to be really clear that in how I worded this, that's kind of an unrealistic assumption. What we're trying to do is create a 95% confidence interval for the average vertical jump of all basketball players. In other words, we don't know the population mean. We're trying to create a confidence interval for that. But somehow we know the population standard deviation. It's not really realistic, but that's how we'll deal with it in question one. That's what you do in 9.1. And then in question two, we'll fix that unrealistic assumption and see what changes. So anyway, in question one, we're given sigma, which is 10, and we want to create a 95% confidence interval for the average vertical jump for all basketball players. The way we'll do it in our class is by stating the shape, the center, and the spread, then drawing the appropriate picture to get our conclusion. Shape, kind of easy because it's always going to be approximately normal in our class, because those are the only kind of distributions we know how to deal with. A little bit more to it now, we learned when we got into sampling distributions that we can justify why it's approximately normal. In this case, it's approximately normal because n, our value for the sample size, is greater than or equal to 30. It was the central limit theorem that says that if n is greater than or equal to 30, we can conclude that the shape is approximately normal. The center of our distribution, we've been using mu as the center, the population mean. However, we don't know mu, we don't know the population mean. That's what we're creating a confidence interval for. So we don't have mu. X bar is kind of our next best thing to use, the sample average. You don't know the population average, use the sample average. The center should be at 38. The spread for our sampling distribution, you use sigma sub x bar to denote that, is given by the formula sigma divided by the square root of n. We're given both sigma, which is 10, and n, which is 100 in this problem. So we can calculate the spread of our sampling distribution here. 10 divided by, this turns out to be 10 also, so you get 1. So we got our shape, our center, and our spread. We can draw a picture. It's a poor attempt at a straight line. Maybe I'll try that again if it lets me. Yep. Good enough. We got this distribution that's approximately normal. Yeah, whatever. And the center of this distribution is at 38. And the spread of this distribution is 1. And what we want to do is we want to figure out two points. Maybe I'll put them here and here. Symmetric about the mean in our picture. So that this shaded region in here is exactly 95%. This is actually a question we've done before in this class. We did this in chapter 7. Did this before the midterm. We use the inverse norm feature on our calculator to figure out these two values. Turns out there's an easier way to do it. You can figure out these two values using the Z interval feature in your calculator. I'll show you that over here. So if you hit the stat button and then go over to tests, you can choose the seventh thing on the list that says Z interval. And if you hit enter, it'll ask you if you have data or statistics. In this case, we have statistics. And the statistics are the things they gave us in the problem. They gave us sigma was equal to 10, x bar was equal to 38, n was equal to 100, and our confidence level is 95%. So if you plug all those in and you hit calculate, what you'll get is 36.04, 39.96. Maybe I'll even write Z interval gives me this. So that's your confidence interval. Those are the two values. Kind of what we're saying here is we don't know what the average vertical jump is for all basketball players. We don't know what mu is. But I am 95% sure that mu is some number between 36.04 and 39.96. Good enough. Guess we can move on to the next one. Next one is very similar. Probably do it a little bit quicker. The only thing that changes in here, well, okay, that's not exactly true. It's very similar. Let's go through and see what we have. First thing, it's a random sample of 81 basketball players. There's our value for N. X bar is 38. That's our average in the sample. And the standard deviation for the sample. Note, this is not the standard deviation of all players. This is the standard deviation of these 81 players. So this is S. This is not sigma. We want to make a 90% confidence interval for the average vertical jump of all basketball players. So it'll start out very similar. The shape's still going to be approximately normal. The reason why, same. Approximately normal because N is still greater than or equal to 30. The center, still X bar. Still don't know mu. That's what we're trying to make our confidence interval for. The spread will be different, although you might have not even noticed that it was different. But we still want to know the standard deviation of our sampling distribution. But in this case, it's going to be S divided by the square root of N because we do not know sigma. We don't know the population standard deviation. We just know the sample standard deviation. So in this case, it's 12 divided by the square root of 81, which is 12 over 9, which is 4/3. Call it 1.33 maybe. No, let's be precise. Why not? Let's call it 4/3. Okay, so we have our shape, our center, and our spread. We go about the problem kind of drawing our picture like we did before. Much better. Middle still 38. Let's see, this time we wanted, a 90% confidence interval. So this time these two values out here should kind of bound 90% of the data. In other words, this shaded region in here should be 0.90. And we can get this out of our calculator also. However, we don't want to use z-interval because the z-interval assumes that you know sigma, the population standard deviation. There's a whole different distribution when you don't know the population standard deviation. When you have to take a guess at that using the sample standard deviation, you have to use a whole different distribution. It's called the T distribution. So on our calculator to figure out these values, I'm going to, instead of using z-interval, I'm going to use t-interval. And that's key. On the t-interval, we need to go further out in order to capture 90% of the data than we do to capture 90% of the data with the z-interval, because we're not even sure if our spread is right, is the way I think about it. We don't know sigma. We just know S. We're kind of guessing at sigma. So just in case this thing's wrong, we better go out further in both directions if we want to get a set amount of data. Anyways, to use t-interval, go under stats, go to tests, and there's the eighth thing on the list. You get this t-interval right here. And be careful. Let's see, x-bar is still 38. Now it's asking for S of x. It's asking for our sample standard deviation. The thing we know here, S, which is 12. Note that it's not asking for sigma, the 10 that we put in before. It's asking for S, the value of 12. You don't want to put in the spread. You don't want to put in 4/3. You want to put in what it's asking for, S, which is 12. N is 81. Confidence level is 90%. If we go down to calculate, we'll get our values. Eventually, we'll get our values. We got 35.78. And our upper bound is 40.22. So we get our confidence intervals from 35.78 to 40.22. We don't know mu. We don't know the population average, but we're 90% sure that it's some number between 35.78 and 40.22. All right, finally, the last problem, the one that's a little bit trickier. This is 9.3. We're dealing with proportions now. See, we again have a random sample of 100 basketball players. So this is our value for N. And we get that 62% of my sample proportion I use p hat for, 62% of my proportion think their vertical is above average. Calculated 99% confidence interval for the proportion of all basketball players that think their vertical is above average. I don't know P. All basketball players, the proportion of them that think their vertical is above average is P. It's similar to mu. We don't know that thing. We do know P hat, the sample proportion, similar to X bar. But we can figure that out. Shape, maybe I'll switch back to red for a while. Shape is approximately normal because it always is. Approx-normal. But we can justify why it's approximately normal. We have a new criteria when we're dealing with proportions. Maybe you remember it from 8.2 with sampling proportions. It's we need n times p times 1 minus p to be greater than or equal to 10. Problem, you don't know p. That's what we're trying to create our confidence interval for. So what can we do? Well, we don't know p, but we do know p hat. So we can use that instead. N times p hat times 1 minus p hat is greater than or equal to 10. Should probably make sure that that's true. It is true, but I can show you that it's true by doing 0.62 p hat times 1 minus 0.62, which is 0.38, times 100, which is n. And what I get is a value greater than or equal to 10. So I get my shape's approximately normal. My center, we've been using p for the center. We don't know p. That's what we're creating a confidence interval for. So instead, we use p hat. Just like we didn't know mu up here, so we instead used x bar. We don't know p, so we instead use p hat. That's 0.62. Spread. The spread for our sample proportion used to be the square root of p times 1 minus p divided by n. This is how we got the spread of our sampling proportion in chapter 8.2. Problem, we don't know p. Probably have a pretty good guess of what we're going to do at this point. We don't know p, we can estimate it with p hat. So just change these in your formula into p hat and figure out this mess. I want the square root of, I want the square root of p is 0.362 times 0.38 divided by 100. Don't have to close the parentheses. It'll close them for you. Gives you 0.0485. Something like that. And now that we have our shape, center, spread, we can draw our picture. I'll draw it approximately normal because it's approximately normal. I'll, in the center, I'll put my value for the center here, 0.62. And then what I will attempt to do is create a 99% confidence interval. I'll choose values out here and out here so that this shaded region in there is, come on, is 0.99, 99%. Unfortunately, my calculator can do that for me. There's a few ways it could do it. You could do it using z-interval, because it turns out this is a z-distribution. But I think there's an easier way. If you hit stat and then go to tests, and we scroll down, there we go. A on this list, the 11th thing on this list, says one prop z-interval. One prop. Come on. Z interval. Okay, what this is saying is one, because we only have one set of data. You might be confused by that. Everything we've been doing is one set of data. Later on, we'll see what happens when you have two. Use two prop Z intervals. But for now, it's just a one prop Z interval. Prop meaning proportion. That's short for proportion. If you hit one prop Z interval, what it will do is ask you for this information and your confidence level, and then it'll calculate the confidence level for you. Something that's a little bit tricky is the things that it asks for is a little bit different than what they've given us. So what I'm trying to say is your calculator calls p hat x over n. So what I'm trying to say here is it's just asking me for x and n. It just wants to know how many, well, n is easy. N is 100, the number of basketball players I have. And it wants to know how many of them think that their vertical is above average. It doesn't want to know what percent of them or what proportion thinks they're above average. It wants to know how many. So in order to end up with 62%, I'd need 62 out of the 100 to think that they're average their vertical is above average. Another way to say that, maybe, or your calculator calls x n times p hat. In other words, if you didn't know what x was, you could say n was 100, p hat is 0.62, so my x must be 62. So when I do my one prop z interval, I put in 62 first for x. If you put in 0.62, you'll get an error. Your computer or your calculator will get confused. N is 100, and my confidence level is 99%. Go down to calculate and hit enter, and it'll give us the endpoint of our interval. So what it does is it now calculates p hat for you. It says p hat is 0.62, right? That's what you meant? Yeah, that's what I meant, 0.62. N is 100. My left endpoint is 49.5, maybe. And my right is 74.5 or 0.745. So what we get is our 99% confidence interval for the proportion of basketball players that think their vertical is above average is from here to here. In other words, I don't know what proportion of all basketball players think their vertical is above average, but I'm 99% sure that it's some proportion between 49.5% and 74.5%. I don't know what it is, but I'm 99% sure it's something between those two values. Whew. All right, so that's the end of this tutorial on how to calculate confidence intervals with your calculator. I'm gonna come back and make another one talking about how to figure out your sample size for a specified margin of error.